previous person. I'm a NEET expert, and I help NEET aspirants to achieve their dreams. And I work in Ask Cadence. I have an experience of almost 9+ years in NEET coaching and other medical entrance examinations. Now let's get into the topic and we'll see what we're going to study today. Okay. So today we're going to discuss about a chapter from 10th standard named R Environment. So in this chapter, we're going to discuss a few points and then we're going to explore on what is this chapter we're going to teach us. Okay. So let's get into the thing. So allow me just a few minutes to get the screen ready. I hope everybody is able to see the screen now. So the chapter name is Our Environment. So this literally means our surroundings, so everything around us. Okay. So when you talk about our environment, it includes like everything, every single organism, a bacteria, a microorganisms, to a macroscopic organism, a plant, a human being, and a dog, cat, and every single organism, and even a non-living component that is around your world, around yourself, that constitute the whole living part is actually the environment. Okay, I hope you all understood this part. So topics which you're going to be covering in this video would be introduction on what is this chapter is all about, and then ecosystem and what is an ecosystem and the components of ecosystem, and then what are producers, what are consumers, and what are decomposers, and what is their importance, like why are they important, and then what is food chain and food web. So quickly, let's get into the topic, shall we? So environment. So can we actually survive this very society without a family? I don't think so, right? So we just need some mental support and financial and every single support that we can avail to actually survive this environment. Right? Same thing. So every single organism or entity or even a non-living factor is going to be supporting the existence of every living organism. So that is called an environment. So environment is everything around us. So it includes both living and non-living. Okay. So example, soil, water, animals, plants, which actually amalgamate in like to forming a whole a functional structure. Okay, so we call that an environment. So it is just a privilege that we have been provided with all the other factors that we share with the nature equally to survive in this period. So that is actually our environment. So we'll quickly get into the ecosystem part. So ecosystem is a small community, okay, that is living in this very earth, okay, which is having a strong relationship with both a biotic and abiotic factors. I hope everybody would have understood what is it abiotic and abiotic factors means. So we're going to study what are abiotic factors and what are biotic factors in detail. With that, it will be easy for us to understand like what is the abiotic components and abiotic components and biotic components, which are a components of ecosystem. Okay. So when we talk about abiotic components, which are non-living substances, which involve inorganic materials like carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and phosphate, and then carbon dioxide and water molecule, all of them are inorganic molecules. So first of all, you should know what does inorganic mean. So inorganic are substances which are available in this very earth, which doesn't require involvement of living organisms in its formation. It's called inorganic material. So I repeat, the substances that is available in this very earth surface from the very first time, which doesn't involve any living organisms help in the formation of those organisms or this components. Okay, so organic materials are any substances that involves a living organisms, influence in formation of that material. So example, carbohydrate, which is produced by plants, and amino acids, which are formed by chemical synthesis, and then like fatty acids, again, digestion and stuff. So these are the simpler compounds, and then formed as a result of decomposition, right? And then other climatic factors. So climatic factors involve the sunlight that is available for the ecosystem to survive, and the temperature that is available by the ecosystem to actually give temperature for each and every living organism, which requires a little temperature to run their life. And then the wind, the humidity, the rainfall, and the air current, which is maintained. So all of these are climatic factors, an edaphic factor. So when you talk about edaphic factor, it is just the soil texture, the porosity of the soil, and then the water that is held in the held by the soil, the amount of water held by the soil. So all of them includes edaphic factor. The next one is topographic factor, which is the geographical characteristics, which is the earth surface. Like what kind of land is this? Like, you know, is it a valley? Is it a mountain? Is it a slope or a plain? Like those are topographic factors. All of these are abiotic factors, which are non-living factors. And then the factors which are biotic in nature, which include different categorization. So one include producers. So producers are green plants or plants which actually are autotrophic. I repeat, autotrophic, A-U-T-O-T-R-O-P-H-I-C, autotrophic. So what is autotrophic actually is? Autotrophic means trofo, means nourishment. And auto means self. So nourishing themselves is called auto nourishment or autotrophic or self-trophic, self-nourishment. So now how do they do it? They actually perform the photosynthesis process. During the process of photosynthesis, with the help of sunlight, the carbon dioxide and water will be like amalgamated, which you have studied in the chapter, nutrition in life process chapter. And nutrition in plants. So sunlight is utilized in photolysis of water, and then the hydrogen is used in reduction of carbon dioxide into energy rich molecule, carbohydrate. So this process results in formation of carbohydrate with oxygen that is liberated out. So this is called photosynthesis. And the next one is the consumers. So consumers are different categories based on the level that they are dependent on producers. So the first degree of dependency was actually found in primary consumers. They are herbivores because producers are green plants, right? Or plants which actually produces their own food. So primary consumers are just herbivores. So they are herbivores by by nutrition or like not nutrition, like, you know, by food habit. So when they talk about herbivores, they feed on, they actually feed on plants. Okay, so they rely on producers directly. And the secondary consumers are the one which they are relying on primary consumers. And the tertiary consumers are the next category, which they rely on secondary consumers. And the quaternary consumers are, they actually rely on both secondary and primary consumers. Okay. So now we have another set of consumers called omnivores. We call it double consumers. What do they do is they will be, they can either be placed in the primary consumer or in the secondary consumer or tertiary consumer. Okay, they are always that way. And the quaternary consumer is always a carnivore. Okay, carnivore. And then decomposers, the next most important biotic component, because the nutrients which are going to be involved in the process of formation of nourishment in by the producers will be transferred from one organism to another, and later they need to be destructed or dismantled, or they have to be made into a simpler compound so that it can again enter into the cycle of production of food. So this is actually done by decomposers. So these are microorganisms and certain other animals which actually breaks down the complex substances into simpler substances which can be used again by the producers for their successive growth. So these are the abiotic and biotic factors of the ecosystem. I hope everybody would have understood what is the abiotic and biotic factors. And let's talk about producers a little bit more. So producers are plants which actually makes or prepares their own food. So they just utilize the sunlight with the help of water and the carbon dioxide that they take in. And with that, they will make sugar. So this sugar molecules will be made into a complex carbohydrate called starch. So this starch molecule is again modified, and it can be modified into cellulose or anything based on the combination that they are made into. So such making of such making of complex molecule is seen in plants. So that's how they actually become the most sustaining organism that could survive in this very world. Okay, so they actually, we can say that the plants doesn't need us very well, very much, because they just need carbon dioxide and water, and then that is naturally available, and it is actually human being who literally destroys the environment. So literally. So these is about producers. The next one is consumers. So consumers are organisms which cannot make their own food. So that is actually a very simpler way to talk about. So they directly or indirectly rely on the consumers. Okay, consumers. So when we spoke about consumers, they were primary. Okay, and then secondary. And then tertiary. So all these three, okay, are different categories. So primary consumers are directly relying on producers, and secondary consumer relies on both producers and primary consumers possible. And tertiary consumers are directly going to rely on primary and secondary consumers. So these are the different types of consumers. And if you talk about, I'm going to explain about food chain in the upcoming slides, I will help you understand, realize the process of what is food chain and which one is consumer, which one is primary, which one is secondary, which one is tertiary, and which one is producer, and every other part. Okay. So next thing that you want to talk about is decomposers. What is the function of decomposing? So why is it called composing? So composing is we actually put different tunes and different sounds in an orchestrated form, and then it is composed into a complex material. Okay, that's how the chemicals are, basic chemicals, basic atoms and molecules are combined to form complex substances, and that's called the organism. So when these organisms are dead, or when the fecal matter is delivered to the land, so they have to be broken down to simpler substances so that the nutrients can be replenished into the environment for the feed. Okay, so this nutrient replenishment can be done, or will be done, by decomposers. So that's why it is very important. If not, there will be no breaking down or refilling of the requirement by the breaking down of complex material. It will not happen if the decomposers are absent. Okay, so that's why decomposers are very important. So earthworm is very famous decomposer, which actually breaks down the complex material into simpler substances, and then they also serve as the nutritious material for the plants to take up. So the next one we'll be talking about food chain. So when you talk about food chain in an ecosystem, there will be reliance of one organism on another, okay, for its food, so that it can acquire energy. So such reliance of an organism on another for its energy requirement in the form of food is called the chain link. So it will contain many link organism. One will be relied upon by organism two. Organism two will be relied upon by organism three. Organism three will be relied upon by organism four. So likewise, it creates a chain, links, because of different links based on their food reliability. So that's how the energy is transferred. Whatever energy that is acquired by the organism one will be transferred to the organism two, but not completely. We'll study about that as an important thing over here. Whatever energy is consumed by two will be transferred to three, not completely again. So whatever energy that is consumed by the third organism will be transferred to four, and not completely again. So this process of transfer of energy from one trophic level, okay, from one organism to another organism in a sequential arrangement of organisms based on their reliance on each other for food is called food chain. The chain links that are nothing but the animals, and what is connecting them is their dependency of the other dependency on the other animals for them as a food. Okay, that's called food chain. So we'll see one of them as example. Here you see grass is a producer, okay, producer, and deer is a primary consumer, wolf is a secondary consumer, and lion is a tertiary consumer. Here see So deer, the deer actually relies on grass, and the wolf actually relies on deer, and the lion actually relies on the wolf. So likewise, the organism's dependency be on the other animals or other organisms for its survival to fulfill its requirement is creating a link between one animal to another. So this link, okay, on their dependency of other organism as for food is actually called food chain. Okay, so let's say for an example, so is it only wolf which can eat the deer? Definitely not. So even a fox, okay, a hyena, so the fox could be relied upon by lion, right? The hyena could also be relied upon by lion. So the hyena could be hunted even by wolf. See, I'm actually trying to create a new food chains, and they are all interconnected with each other. So that is what we are going to see. So whatever we saw earlier was food chain, where it will be linear in nature, when many linear chains are interconnected due to common preferences, is called food web. So food web consists of more than one food chain combined together, and they are all joined at a particular point due to common preferences that they have. So this is actually a food chain over here, you can see. So here, a python actually relies on rat, and rat is eaten even by an eagle, and even hunted by a wolf, and a frog is also eaten by python. A wolf is also eaten by a python. So in this way, you can understand the process that how one animal actually depends on several animals for food. And such dependency that they have on other animals literally make them interconnected with each other, forming a food web, which is many food chains combined together that are interconnected with each other. So this is called food web, okay, which clearly helps us understand the process of dependency, or the dependency of one organism on another organism, or more than one organism, and how they are interconnected with each other, depending on the other organisms for their energy consumption and requirement fulfillment. Okay, so this is actually food web. I hope every one of you understood what is food web. Okay, so we have few questions which we can discuss on this. So the main function of an environment is, so it has to supply the resources. So it should also, so when can somebody, when will somebody go to a shop to purchase something? Only when they have something with them, so that the people can buy. So the environment should always be equipped with the resources, so that the environment will be lively all the time. So it will become functional. And it should also, when the resources are going to be there, it should also have all the abiotic factors fulfilled to sustain life in that region. Okay, and then when the environment is going to be persisting, the resources have to be utilized by this life, and there should be assimilation of waste. So the waste has to be assimilated, and then it has to be restoring the resources that were supplied to the environment. And after that, by the following three processes, it should actually make sure that there is an enhancement in the quality of life. So the organism's existence in this very world and the life has to be excellent. So that's the functions of environment. So next thing, what are the benefits of decomposers? As I've already told you, decomposers are the main organisms which is going to convert the complex organisms into simpler substances. And when they do so, they take care of the replenishment of the chemical nutrients that were absorbed by the plants for the process of survival and making other nutrients. But when they are devoid of it, when they've already used everything, so whatever leaves that they shed, whatever plants that they die, whatever animals defecate, all these materials have to be recycled. And the recycled matter will be forming the new base for the plants to grow. So that function of maintaining a cyclic nutrient cycle is maintained. Maintained by decomposers. to sustain the environment. Okay, so that is the function of decomposers. I hope every one of you have learned something really interesting and important. I'm really happy to teach you guys. And we have, and please go through all the content one more time in your book. And if you have any doubts, please post those questions. And then, like, you know, in the forum, we have exclusive teachers who are working on that. And then we always be quick in responding to your answers. And the next important thing is, like, you know, I'm happy that you have enjoyed the video. Like, don't stop there. You just need to attend some of our live classes. You will be more interactive, and you will definitely enjoy it. And the things that you have in your mind can be, like, you know, clarified and can be rectified. Answers will be gained in the real time. So that will actually help you learn much interactive. Okay. So I hope everybody understood. Thank you so much for your time.